Good morning, and welcome to the second week of our course, Mary Cassatt. I'm Jasmine Hagens, curator of lectures, courses, and concerts here at the MFA. And it's my honor to welcome you to today's talk, An American in Paris, Cassatt, Degas, and the Impressionists in the 1870s, presented by Erica Hirshler, Croll Senior Curator of American Paintings. And in honor of Cassatt, I want to wish us all a happy, or at least recognized, Equal Pay Day. I think that Cassatt would have supported this day of recognition for the gender wage gap. Yeah. Hirshler is a scholar of late 19th and early 20th century American painting, particularly of the work of John Singer Sargent and Mary Cassatt. Hirshler is interested in the vibrant artistic exchange between the United States and Europe that characterizes the period. She also studies patronage and collecting, women artists, and Boston art and history. Hirshler holds a BA from Wellesley College and a PhD from Boston University. Her popular book, Sargent's Daughters, The Biography of a Painting, in 2009, reveals the multiple facets of Sargent's greatest masterpiece, The Daughters of Edward Darley Boyd. Her most recent book centers on another icon of the MFA's collection, Child Hossam's At Dusk, Boston Common at Twilight, and both books are available in the bookstore for a member discount. She has lectured and published widely, in addition to curating exhibitions such as John Singer Sargent Watercolors in 2013, and the exhibition this upcoming fall here at the MFA on William Merritt Chase. Please join me in welcoming Erica Hirshler.
Thank you so much, Jasmine, and thanks to all of you for being with us this morning. I'm going to remind you all again, please turn these off or put them on silent. I tend to get distracted when I hear them ring because I always think it's for me. We had a wonderful introduction last week from Elliot Boswick Davis about Cassatt's family, her background, and her early career, and she also laid out some of the themes that will be common across the four lectures of this course. Today, we'll come back to a little bit of that material and also think about, together, Cassatt as an American in Paris. We see her here in a variety of different guises. On the left, as she saw herself in two self-portraits, one from 1880 at the top left, one from 1878 at the lower left, pictures that I find visually sort of remarkably timid or self-effacing for a woman who really was someone of incredible determination and acumen. In the center, we see her as Degas depicted her, less ladylike in posture, a painting that she actually didn't like, but to my mind, someone who definitely leaned in, if I can put it that way. And on the right, as she presented herself to the camera, as a young woman in Italy in 1872, on the upper right, looking rather like an ingenue, and at the bottom right, in a photograph from 1914, as a self-confident and regal lady of a certain age. Well, who's the real Cassatt? And that's something I hope to look at with you today. You'll remember from last week that Cassatt received her early training in Philadelphia, where she, like most aspiring young artists, would begin to learn how to be an artist by learning to draw after classical casts. And I'm showing you at lower left the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts building as it exists today, built in the 1870s, and thus post-dating Cassatt's attendance there. At the top, one of the sculptures from the Parthenon frieze, and on the right, a beautiful drawing by an American artist named Thomas Anschutz that just shows one of these women in one of these classes at the Academy drawing a cast of that very sculpture. Cassatt entered the antique class, as it was called, at the Pennsylvania Academy just before her 16th birthday. The Pennsylvania Academy was one of the oldest art schools in the country. It was founded in 1805, and although women had attempted to become active participants in their art school programs from the beginning, they weren't allowed to study painting there until 1844, the year of Cassatt's birth. By the late 1850s, about 14% of the students studying antique drawing were women, although they were still excluded from the life classes that were offered to their male colleagues. Many people felt it wasn't worth the investment to train women how to be artists. Even the father of Eliza Haldeman, Cassatt's good friend, and a woman who did go on to have a professional career of her own, her father wrote to Eliza when she was a student, and I quote, "You will get married and settle down into a good housekeeper like all married women, and send off your paints into the garret. There's a prediction for you, and one founded on almost universal experience." Hardly encouraging. Not only were most American art schools deficient in training opportunities for women, there was also little inspiration here in the United States for art students, no matter what their sex. Museums like the MFA itself, or the Metropolitan, or the Corcoran didn't yet exist. And there was little room for art in the American soul. Cassatt had been exposed to culture during her early European travels with her family, which you heard about last week, and also with her friends. But when she was forced to return to the U.S. in 1870, when the Franco-Prussian War broke out and Paris was not a good place to be, she was in exile again. As she wrote in June 1871 from Hollidaysburg, Pennsylvania, to her friend Emily Sartain, and I quote, "I cannot tell you what I suffer for the want of seeing a good picture." She returned to Europe as soon as she could, and like most aspiring American artists during the last third of the 19th century, she headed straight to Paris. Paris was the capital of the art world in the late 19th century, and thousands of artists from all countries flocked there to take advantages of the opportunities that that city had to offer, its art schools, its exhibition opportunities, and the original works of art from which to study. For Americans in particular, it also offered something else, a place where art was really central to everyday life. Few of the American painters who made their homes in the French capital were immune from this idea of this central position of art, especially the idea of the bohemian artist that had been established in the 1840s by the French writer Henri Murger, who you see here in a photograph at the right. And on the left, I'm showing you a French painting by an artist named Octave Tasser, which simply shows you one of these poor, starving artists burning his last stick in the fireplace while his easel stands at right. He's peeling potatoes because that's all he's got to eat. And that romantic notion of a world in which domestic hardships could be overlooked in the pursuit of artistic ideals was very current during Cassatt's time. And in a lot of ways, it was the ultimate rejection of a self-satisfied life practiced by the typically practical American bourgeoisie. In other words, people who asked you how you were going to make a living at that. Bohemians, instead, were free to talk about art, to discuss new ideas and artistic styles instead of that business of earning a living. And I'd remind you that the ideas of Murger became even more prominent later in the century. The book was translated into English in 1888, and of course became the subject of Puccini's great opera in 1896, La Bohème. Paris and La Vie de Bohème was a potent elixir for would-be painters from a country where many viewed art with suspicion, and I would say that many still do, I'm afraid. The trip across took only about a week by Cassatt's day, and I'm showing you a painting from our own collection called On the Open Sea, the Transatlantic Steamship Pereire from 1877, which shows you the varied activities of different classes of people on shipboard. But I want to remind you that communication had changed so much during the 19th century. Not only was the trip much faster than it had ever been, but there were things like cables and illustrated publications that brought the news back and forth across the Atlantic very quickly. And when an artist arrived, they were in heaven. I'm just showing you here a wonderful watercolor in our own collection by Edward Darley Boyd, someone you may have heard of, his Place de l'Opéra from 1883. As Henry Tuckerman remarked in 1867, when Cassatt was in this position, Tuckerman wrote, "When arrived in Paris, the dissatisfied spirit of a young artist was completely soothed. Instead of feeling himself overpowered by the commercial spirit of his own country, one of a neglected minority striving in vain to excite interest in a vocation too profitless for a community absorbed in trade, politics, and fashion, now, in Paris, he experienced the advantage of a recognized class, a fraternity in art, galleries, studios, lectures, models, criticism, illustrious men, noble examples, friendly words, and a true companionship that made his life one of self-respect, of growing knowledge, and assured satisfaction." Or if I can just put it in another way, as that painter who did the shipboard picture, Henry Bacon, put it in 1882, "He'd rather live in Paris on a crust than in any other city on six courses and dessert." Paris wasn't just the capital of the art world, but it was, of course, the epitome of modern fashion, of marketing, a cultural center where theater, music, dance, and sophisticated entertainments became a suitable subject for art. In its parks, you could find scenes of great beauty and also the momentary glimpses of contemporary life that captured the attention of modern painters, including, for a time, John Singer Sargent, whose view of the Luxembourg Gardens in 1879 you see here. Its boulevards were just being completed with their elegant enfilade of regulated architecture and strategically sited monuments, like the Arc de Triomphe, which you just see here at the edge of Child Hassam's composition, Grand Prix Day. The busy traffic of the Grand Boulevards, there are omnibuses piled high with passengers, which Hassam shows you at upper left in a scene from 1888, or in our own collection, the stylish Parisians on the parade on their way to the Grand Prix, one of the oldest and most prestigious horse races in Europe. There was also cafe culture, which we knew that Cassatt enjoyed. One of her friends described an evening where the ladies all went out for ices. And I'm showing you here two American painters' views of cafes, both of which showing women engaged in them. On the left, Willard Metcalf's Au Café from 1888, and on the right, John White Alexander's In the Café from 1898. And there were even more entertainments, circuses and concerts, depicted by artists like Degas in his Miss Lala at the Cirque Fernando, a painting we'll come back to in a minute, from about 1878, and from around the same time, Sargent's wonderful image of the Pas de Loup Orchestra as they performed in another circus environment, the Cirque d'Hiver, in 1879. And of course, there was art. But I want you to remember what kind of art was most valued during this time. And it's not necessarily what you would expect from our own Impressionist-loving perspective. On the top, you see the leading French painter in all of Paris for years and years and years, William Adolphe Bouguereau, in his studio. And one of his paintings on the right, his Birth of Venus from 1879, now at the Musée d'Orsay. On the lower left, you see another hero of French art, Jean-Léon Gérôme, who Eliot mentioned last week, sitting in his studio, and on the right, the MFA's Moorish Bath from 1875. Most Americans, and most Europeans, in fact, liked this kind of painting, and the creators were seen as the most admired heroes of the art world during this period. This kind of painting was based on mastery of rendering the human form. They often are large-scale pictures, like the Bouguereau that you see at the top, which is about 8 feet tall. Clearly, in both of these images, the artists knew how to render human anatomy, and they had mastered complex lessons about line, composition, and color. As we heard last week, Cassatt's earliest work, like her study of the mulatto Mrs. Curry on the left from 1871, show how she, like many of her compatriots, aspired to these same ideals, the attempt to learn how to beautifully render in three dimensions a solid human figure. I'm comparing it with a work on the right by another American woman artist who was active in Paris, a woman that you may not be familiar with. Her name was May Alcott. You might have heard of her fictional counterpart, Amy, in Little Women, who was based on Louisa May Alcott's sister, May, who exhibited her study of a black woman at the Salon in 1879, a painting I'm showing you here on the right. What I hope I'm telling you is that all in all, Paris was a game changer. I'm showing you here two self-portraits by the same person. Thomas Hovenden, an American painter who started his career in New York and then went to Paris. Guess which one was painted in New York and which one was painted in Paris. These are 5 years apart. I think you can tell that American aspiring artists became much more comfortable with their art and with themselves in Paris. Nevertheless, there were reservations about living the artist's life, particularly for women. And even Cassatt's father disapproved. Cassatt later told her biographer that her father told her he would almost rather see her dead than off to Paris to take on the life of a painter. How could a woman do what the guy on the right is doing? Just not done. So that's one of the reasons that Cassatt ends up going to Paris with friends and also with her mother, who stayed there until she was properly settled. Well, even when a woman arrived in Paris, properly chaperoned, living in one of the pensions recommended by May Alcott, who wrote a book for women artists called How to Study Art in Paris and Do It Cheaply, their situation was very different from that of their male colleagues. And for one thing, let me just tell you that women were not admitted to the most prestigious art school in Paris, the École des Beaux-Arts, which you see here in an interior and exterior view. Women were not admitted there until 1897. Instead, aspiring female painters like Cassatt turned to private lessons from individual instructors. Or, after 1880, and I would remind you that this is well after Cassatt's early student life, to independent academies like the one that you see on the left, the Académie Julien. Actually, these are both images of the Académie Julien, on the left by an American artist named Jefferson Chalfont. And please don't worry about Jefferson Chalfont. This is really an illustration for you of the Académie Julien, which was one of the first art schools in Paris to admit women. Charge them twice as much, I might add. There were also many independent and private academies or private lessons with opportunities for women to become artists. And Cassatt, as you learned last week, studied privately with a number of different academic painters. Despite obstructions like this, Cassatt was among many other American women artists who pursued their careers abroad, like Elizabeth Gardner, who you see at upper left, who had a very successful career as a polished salon artist of mythological and peasant scenes, painted very much in the style of Bouguereau, who she most adamantly admired, began to live with, later married, and soon kind of stopped painting so much. Or Elizabeth Nourse, who you see here at lower left, another American woman artist who expatriated to Paris, who was properly chaperoned in that she, too, lived with her sister and had, a wonderful and successful career within the salon system. At the upper right, an artist you might have heard of, Cecilia Beaux, who you see here in a self-portrait from the 1890s. Cecilia Beaux, a fellow Philadelphian with a French family background, who came to Paris to study, but then made her career back in the United States. Or our own painting at lower right of Ellen Day Hale, another aspiring woman painter who pursued her studies in Paris. This wonderful self-portrait from 1885 at lower right, definitely the product of her study of avant-garde French art like Manet in Paris in 1883. And I was so pleased to see the star of a recent Sebastian Smee frame by frame article in the Globe last week. They weren't all Americans either. Cassatt found herself in a community of women artists in France, women like Marie Bachelet, who you see at upper left in a photograph, a woman who equally had a wonderful career at the Salon. She was of Russian origin, but made her career in Paris. The most famous 19th century woman artist of the day, Rosa Bonheur, who you see at lower left in a portrait made by her companion, Anna Klumpke. She was the most famous animalier, or animal painter, of the period. One reason being that it was really easy for women to go to the zoo to look and see how to paint animals. Getting into a life class with a man in it was another story altogether. Or on the right, two women who were part, as Cassatt was, of the Impressionist circle. Berthe Morisot, who you see at upper right in a painting by Manet from the Orsay, or at lower right, Eva Gonzalez, one of the lesser known women who participated in the Impressionist exhibitions, again in a portrait by Manet, now in the National Gallery in London. So I hope by telling you all this, you'll know that Cassatt was by far from the only woman artist, either American or French, and that women artists in Paris could either go with the salon system or become more avant-garde in their outlook. And And although Cassatt and her colleagues were unable to do a lot of things, like study at the Ecole, they were able to participate in the other fundamental building blocks of learning how to be an artist. They could, for example, copy the great masters at the Louvre, home to one of the finest art collections in the world, where, if you've ever been there, you know that it still has the power to defeat even the most intrepid museum goer. And I'm showing you here the long gallery at the Louvre, which has killed many an American tourist. On the upper left, in a sort of fantastical rendition by the French painter Hubert Robert from the 18th century, and at the lower right, Winslow Homer's view of students copying at the Louvre from 1867. And I think you can make out that both men and women are lined up doing just that. Women were also able to take advantage of the enormous displays of contemporary art that were held in Paris, at the Salon, at the World's Fairs, all of which had an art component, and shows at the new independent exhibitions that were organized by numerous art dealers in Paris. Exhibiting in Paris, particularly at the Salon, was tremendously important to an artist who sought to establish a professional reputation. Success at the Salon was almost a requirement to wider recognition and acclaim, both in Europe and in America, and that's the power of the press and the quickness of the press during this period. When American reviewers wrote about the Paris Salon and their articles appeared in the American press just about within the week. The Salon was held annually from the middle of the Second Empire to about 1898 when its rules changed in the vast spaces of the Palais de l'Industrie, which you see here at the upper left. It's a building that no longer exists, but it sat where the Grand Palais and the Petit Palais now sit, so you can imagine how big it was. And it saw crowds of up to 10,000 people a day attempting to look at thousands of paintings and pieces of sculpture that were on display every year. It's hard to overestimate the importance of the press's influence in the international reports on these exhibitions. And I'm showing you at the lower right a view, actually, of another kind of exhibition, the World's Fair. If you're looking, that's the Boyts right there in the 1889 World's Fair. But I want to talk about the power of the press, and I show you here at right the French caricaturist Honoré Daumier's Promenade of the Important Critic. And I think you can see all the artists tipping their hats to the man who's walking through looking at their work. The press gave credence to returning artists, ensuring that they could point to their Salon success when they started to establish their careers back in the United States. And the innate conservatism of most American buyers of art during this period meant that that credential, that medal, that report was of great importance. The Salon was the place to establish your reputation and to prove that you were serious. But it wasn't easy. The Salon was a juried system. And I'm showing you on the left a painting I love by a French artist named Henri Gervex, showing you a session of the Salon jury painted in the early 1880s, a painting now at the Musée d'Orsay. And on the right, a French painting by a prominent academician named Lefebvre called Truth from 1870. I just want to point out that it's this kind of picture that's being judged by all these men raising their flags saying, yeah, that's a good one, let's put that in the show. So acceptance to the Salon really depended entirely on the jury. And even when the jury accepted a work to be displayed by an artist, sometimes they would find that it was hung so high in this enormous exhibition that it was almost invisible. And that's what it means when you hear that a painting has been skied. It's up in the sky. And what you really wanted was to be hung on the line, in other words, at eye level, where somebody could actually see it. And part of the impetus for painting great big pictures was so that they had to be noticeable in this enormous exhibition. And Cassatt was anxious to prove herself within this system. And I'm showing you here two paintings that you saw last week, which are two paintings that Cassatt exhibited at the Salon. In 1872, she showed two women throwing flowers during the carnival, and on the right in 1873, offering the panal, which is this sort of sugary drink that this woman is holding in a glass that the toreador is dipping his cookie into. Let's not go there. She showed that work in 1873. And I'm showing them to point out again that this is the kind of painting that Cassatt was making in the hope of succeeding within traditional approaches to art. These are very accomplished modeling of the human form, that important thing that was the bedrock of the academic style. It's interesting to me that she showed both of these paintings under the name Mary Stevenson. Just in case Cassatt didn't get into the Salon, she was covering herself. They were also, I think one of them is signed M. Stevenson, which further disguises the issue of whether or not you were a woman artist. Cassatt was doing pretty well at this point, and May Alcott described Cassatt and her studio in November 1876. May Alcott wrote, she visited Cassatt, and she saw, and I quote, her carved chairs on Turkish rugs with superb tapestries in the background and fine pictures on the walls looking down from splendid frames. Statues and articles of vertu filled the corners, the whole being lighted by a great antique hanging lamp. Miss Cassatt was charming as usual, very lively, and a woman of real genius. She will be a first-class light as soon as her pictures get a little circulated and known, for they are handled in a masterly way. With a touch of strength, one seldom finds coming from a woman's fingers. I guarantee you, though, if Cassatt had continued to make paintings like these, we probably wouldn't all be here talking for several weeks about her work. What happened? What happened to shift Cassatt into the painter that we know? Well, the credit is usually given to her friend and associate Edgar Degas, who you see here at upper left, in a self-portrait from 1872 in the Gulbenkian collection in Lisbon. And I'm showing you at the right his rehearsal of the ballet on stage from 1874, about from the Metropolitan Museum's collection, the painting that most people think is one of the first ones that Cassatt and Havemeyer saw. I prefer to think of Degas as a catalyst for ideas that Cassatt already had begun to have. And I just want to parse out the statement that she made when she looked at Degas' work. And I quote, "I saw painting as I wanted to see it. I began to live." She was already looking for something. Looking for something that she found in Degas' work. Well, let's step back for just a minute and look at this group of modern painters with whom Cassatt began to associate. Here's the picture that has given the painting the name of this movement, its name. This is Monet's Impression Sunrise from 1872, now in the Marmottan Museum in Paris. And by and large, most people's general understanding of what Impressionism was all about is dominated by the work of this man, Monet, whose ephemeral scene of the harbor and his hometown of Le Havre has given the movement its lasting name, the idea that Impressionism is all about ephemerality, about capturing a moment in time. But neither the name, nor the style, nor the participants in the group can be so easily grouped. The painters who participated in the Impressionist exhibitions number about 30 individuals, if you count all of the artists involved in each of the 8 exhibitions. And in fact, they're really only united by their desire to show their work outside of that juried system of the Salon exhibition. And they originally didn't call themselves the Impressionists. They called themselves the Independents. In other words, independent of the jury system. They follow in a fairly long tradition of painters who felt that the leading establishment exhibitions, most often selected by a jury, had wrongly omitted their work. It happens in New York, it happened in Boston, it happened in Paris, it happened in London. Eliot spoke last week about the independent Courbet and Manet exhibitions, for example, that took place in the 1860s. Well, this group of artists began to talk about holding their own show as early as 1867. But in fact, the first Impressionist show, or Independence show, didn't come together until 1874. It opened in April 1874, and it ran for only a month. 30 painters in that first exhibition, calling themselves the Société Anonyme, a name later taken up by a much more modern group of painters. Those of you who are Yalies may know that there's a big group of modern paintings called the Société Anonyme collection at Yale. There was no jury for that show. All the members of the Société could show their work, and the hanging position in the gallery was determined by lot. So everybody had an equal chance to show their work on the line. And it was a strikingly eclectic display of both more traditional and more modern works in all media, 165 paintings. You'll be glad I'm not showing all of them to you, but I want to concentrate instead on the core members of the group, the painters we now know best as the Impressionists. On the upper left, you see again Monet's Impression Sunrise, 1872. On the right, Degas' Carriage at the Races from our own collection, also from 1872. At the lower left, Berthe Morisot's The Cradle, also from 1872, now at the Orsay. And at the lower right, Renoir's The Loge, a brand new painting from 1874, now in the Courtauld in London. Now, just showing you these core members, who we call the Impressionists, we can see how the aesthetic of the group varied widely. From the loosely, freely brushed, watery scene of Monet at the upper left, to the carefully studied, tightly rendered horse and carriage of Degas at the right. Subjects about people in public, like Renoir's view of a couple at the theater at lower right, and private scenes, intimate scenes of home life, like Morisot's vision of her sister and her baby at lower left. There were many, many positive reviews of this exhibition, but of course it's the negative ones that we recall. Here, just one cartoon from the French press of the Nouvelle École, the new school of the independent painters, which more or less says outside of their control, let's wish them all the best. And you can see him here painting with a mop instead of a paintbrush that reflects the loose stroke of an artist like Monet. One critic, Emile Cardon, wrote that the works in the exhibition were simply insulting. They negated the most elemental rules of drawing and painting, he said. The scribblings of a child have a naivete and sincerity that make you smile, but the debaucheries of this school are nauseating and revolting. Even 3 years later, J. Alden Weir, one of the very few Americans to comment at an early date about these radical painters, in 1877, visited the third Impressionist exhibition. And just to give you an American point of view about these artists, Weir wrote, "I went across the river the other day to see an exhibition of a work of a new school, which call themselves the Impressionists. I never in my life saw such horrible things. I understand they are mostly all rich, which accounts for so much talk. They do not observe drawing or form, but give you an impression of what they call nature. It was worse than a chamber of horrors. I was there for about a quarter of an hour. I left with a headache. But I told the man exactly what I thought. One franc entree, I was mad for 2 or 3 days. Not only at having paid the money, but for the demoralizing effect of that it must have had on many." Typical of the negative press, but undismayed, the avant-garde artist went on to have a second display in 1876, where a few other paintings you may know showed up. Upper left, Gustave Caillebotte, one of the main instigators and organizers of these shows, who showed in 1876 his floor scrapers, now in the Orsay, from the year before, 1875. Degas showed his cotton exchange in New Orleans from 1873 at the upper right. Monet showed his Seine at Argenteuil from 1875 at lower left, and Renoir showed his portrait of Monet from 1875 at lower right. Again, a lot more artists than you might think. 19 artists, 248 works. Lots of attention, again, both positive and negative. And once again, I want to point out that these are works completely disunited by any school or aesthetic agenda, but instead the group was motivated more by a shared desire to have an opportunity to show their work outside the jury system and to be able to put it in front of the public and to do what else? Sell it. Because if you keep it in your studio, chances are you're not going to be able to sell. The third Impressionist exhibition was held the following year in 1877. And again, we see a variety of artists represented. Caillebotte, again, upper left, in his great Paris Rainy Day, now in the Art Institute of Chicago, from the year the show opened, 1877. At the upper right, Degas Dancers at the Bar, just finished in about 1877, now in the collection of the Metropolitan, thanks to the good eye of Louisine Havemeyer, who we heard about last week. At the lower left, Monet's Arrival of the Normandy Train at the Gare Saint-Lazare, a brand new series of images of the train station that he presented there, this particular one from the Art Institute of Chicago, and an artist who is best known for work he did later, but who is someone who exhibited a couple of times with the Impressionist group, at the lower right, Paul Cézanne, whose fantasy scene from about 1873 you see at lower right. It's also known as The Fisherman. Again, 241 works by 18 artists. Caillebotte, the main organizer and cheerleader. And there were still negative reviews, but many positive ones. But an economic downturn that began that spring, just as that show opened, kept it from being financially successful as the artists had hoped. And although they had wanted to have a fourth show in 1878, it just didn't happen. We do know, though, that the earliest document that discusses that 1878 exhibition that never happened is in a letter from Cassatt to J. Alden Weir, the man who hated the third show so much. In it, Cassatt explained that she couldn't offer her work to be shown in New York, as Weir had asked her, because of the independent show planned for Paris. Clearly, by 1878, she had thrown in her lot with the new painting. By this point, Cassatt is really painting for herself without trying to accommodate tradition. She had become impatient with convention and found a new model for art within the Impressionist circle. And I'm showing you here her little girl in the blue armchair again from 1878 in the National Gallery. I think you can see, though, that that academic training is still a part of her work. Look how firmly and solidly that little girl is modeled. She used the daughter of friends of Degas as her model, and she composed an informal scene of a child sprawled in a richly furnished domestic interior. And her dog rests in a chair at left, and the deep background space ends with a series of French doors. And it's that area in the background where the floor meets the wall of windows where Degas seems to have advised Cassatt on her composition and maybe even added some brush strokes. What we see is Cassatt capturing a young girl during a moment between rest and play. Her white dress completely disheveled, her limbs akimbo. Cassatt had submitted this painting to the jurors of the American section of the 1878 World's Fair. They rejected it, no doubt offended by what they saw as its lack of finish, its distorted perspective, and the ill manners of that little girl. She had a very different approach to painting and was fiercely independent. And Cassatt was enraged when that jury rejected the picture, and she included it in the Impressionist exhibition that was held, the fourth exhibition that was held in 1879. As you know, she was the only American to exhibit with the group. And just to point out how unconventional that picture is, I want to show you it in comparison to an artist we usually think of as being a little more avant-garde. This is Sargent's Robert de Sivrieux from 1879, just about the same year, from our own collection on the right. The formality of the little boy posing at the right compared to the informality of Cassatt's picture on the left. The idea of finish and proper perspective, evident in Sargent's work, but very much in a much more experimental mode in Cassatt's At the Left. So she showed the little girl in the blue armchair, and probably also these pictures in that first display with the Impressionist group in 1879. On the top left, her woman reading from 1878, a painting now in Omaha, Nebraska. At the upper right, her In the Loge from the Philadelphia Museum of Art from 1879. And at the bottom center, her pastel, also in the Philadelphia Museum from about 1879, and also called In the Loge. Part of the reason I'm telling you all of that is it's been very difficult to figure out from the exhibition catalogs just what Cassatt displayed in that first exhibition, because they were all called In the Loge. But what I want to point out is that this first display included mostly images of women and a great number of women at the theater, a theme that she had been exploring for some time in her work, and particularly in this one, In the Loge, first exhibited in 1878 as At the Français, a sketch, a painting from our own collection, which apparently was not included in the first Impressionist exhibition. What it is a fascinating view of the turn Cassatt's work had taken. And the one of the tip-offs that tells you a little bit more about it is the title under which it was first shown in 1878. And it's Cassatt who later changed the title to In the Loge, to go with all the other In the Loge pictures. Thank you. But At the Français is a very particular place. The Français is the theater that I'm showing you on the right. It's the Théâtre Français in the center of Paris. You see the exterior and an interior view on the right. Of all the Americans to record the entertainments of Paris, Cassatt certainly spent the most attention on that subject. And she made, as you can see, and as I have shown and will show, a large series of paintings showing fashionable women attending the theater. Each of them focused more on the audience than on the performance. One of the things that tells you that Cassatt was completely at home in Paris, and which has driven many of my colleagues to even consider her a French rather than an American painter, is a painting like the one on your left. Think about it. Who can go to a performance, for example, of Molière at the Théâtre Français, known for its performances of the French playwright Molière? It's not someone who doesn't speak French. And so it's a sort of self-selecting group of the American artists who are able to integrate intimately with French artistic society. It's Cassatt, it's Sargent, it's Whistler, it's the artists who were fluent in French. For Cassatt and her fellow Impressionists, the theater supplied an elegant and ornate setting filled with dazzling light and an audience of thoroughly modern people, a perfect opportunity to capture the essence of modern life. And her pictures, with their opera glasses and mirrors, as we'll see in a moment, are really about the spectacle of the theater, about looking and being looked at. Cassatt's women are active in inspecting their surroundings, comfortable with the knowledge that they, too, are being observed. And this is just a detail from the painting on the left. Actually, Cassatt even extends that conceit to us, her audience, the viewers of the painting, who become part of her sophisticated and fluctuating dance between subject and object, viewer and viewed. the woman is looking across. The man is looking at her. We are looking at both of them. These are about the activity of looking. The women aren't just spectacles of visual delight meant to be admired, but they look too. And it's that act of looking that I think is Cassatt's real interest. Both of these paintings, the Boston one on the left and the Philadelphia one on the right, show women provocatively on display. One thing that I find interesting is that our painting on the left shows a woman dressed for a matinee performance with a high neck and long sleeves. The woman on the right is dressed for an evening performance with a lot of décolletage and a sleeveless dress. So we have a daytime picture and a nighttime picture, and I'm interested in how that might connect with the print series that Elliot talked about last week, the jour et nuit series of black and white prints that Degas, Pissarro, and Cassatt were working on at just this same time. And I bring you examples of those compositions, Degas at the upper left of Mary Cassatt in the Etruscan Gallery at the Louvre, Pissarro's Woods at Hermitage, Pontoise at the lower left, and Cassatt's own in the Opera Box number 3 on the right. These prints, of course, in multiple versions, all of these experiments for that black and white journal that actually never appeared, but was a time of great excitement and experimentation. The other thing we see in Cassatt's work at this moment is that she shared Degas' fascination with fans. And she addressed his proposal that was part of the fourth Impressionist exhibition to dedicate a room to fans in that show. And you see her using over and over again that motif. And I want to point out that they're unconventional in another way, because these works, both of which are on paper, employ metallic paints and gouache, just the kind of decoration that actually appeared on fans themselves, which often used metallic paint to catch the light as a woman used them. And Cassatt brings that technique of fan painting to her work on an easel. Just to reemphasize this idea of the collaboration between Degas and Cassatt on this idea of the fan, I show you here these pictures. On the top, a fan that Degas painted, ballet dancers from 1879, shown in this exhibition and now in the collection of the Met. This is the show that Cassatt showed her Loge pictures with fans. And it's interesting to note that this eventually belonged to Cassatt right after the show, and this belonged to Degas. And we can see Cassatt making use of the fan in her portrait of Madame J from 1880, now in Baltimore, or even late in her life in this photograph taken around 1904 by Theodate Pope, where it appears on the wall in the background. This is an object she loved. She said it was the most beautiful fan that Degas had ever painted, and she kept it. Eventually, it entered the collection of her friend Louisine Havemeyer, from whence it went to the Met. And Degas also owned this very print from 1880. It's called In the Loge, I'm sorry. This print in the MFA's own collection, this very one, belonged to Degas. And so what I hope I'm conveying by showing you all of these is that this isn't a relationship between student and teacher, a dominant male and a submissive female, but a vibrant relationship with constant give and take and exchange of ideas. But let's think about them together and think about how they are similar and also how they are different. And here is Miss Lala again. Miss Lala at the Cirque Fernando on the left from 1878 in the National Gallery in London. And on the right, Cassatt's In the Loge from the same time from Philadelphia. Both show women who are, in their own way, performing. Miss Lala. Obviously, she was a circus performer and a very well-known one at that. A woman, too, puts on a performance when she puts on a dress like that to go to the theater where the lights, I want you to know, were not dimmed so that you could have a good chance to see who was there and what they were wearing. But despite the rather bold display that Cassatt shows on the right, she did care about certain conventions. And it's the historian, the feminist historian Griselda Pollock, who was the first to lay out this difference in subject matter between the male Impressionists and the female Impressionists, something she called the spaces of femininity. And we do tend to see a difference there. Upper class men, after all, could be seen anywhere. Upper-class women were much less likely to be going slumming at some café concert with the prostitutes. Even though Cassatt and her fellow women artists were professionals, exhibiting regularly, dealing with the art market, selling their work, placing things with collectors, striving to be accepted not just as good women painters, but as good painters, their goals didn't necessarily include the subversion of social custom. I also think that something surrounding nationality and social class has something to do with this in Cassatt's case. In Degas, we have an insider, a Frenchman, versus Cassatt. No matter how integrally involved she was always the American. And also a woman. So while Cassatt used very radical painting styles, she didn't paint the same kinds of pictures as Degas did. Nevertheless, her subject matter, even though it might reflect her status as a woman, her style did not. And her pictures like these, the one on the left, helpfully called At the Theater, now in the Nelson Atkins Museum, her style, her color, her brashness is equal to what the Impressionist male artists were doing. It equally captures the effect of gaslighting in these modern, bright theatrical settings. And Cassatt even went one step further, because when she showed these works in the Impressionist exhibition, she framed them in bright red and bright green frames, calling attention to the color contrasts and using the frames to make the colors of her pictures seem even brighter. Of course, Cassatt also made more feminine domestic subjects, and we think of them really as the main subject of her art. But that too is a very modern idea. Think about the paintings that were conventionally considered important. Biblical and mythological scenes, like the Bouguereau I showed you earlier, episodes from literature, the Bible, and history. Cassatt questions in pictures like these, as do many of the Impressionists, she questions the very nature of what an important painting should be, how it should appear, what it should depict. And to many people, part of the problem with these pictures was that the subjects were trivial. They weren't suitable for great art. So the tea from 1880 from our own collection, which you see here, was included in the fifth Impressionist exhibition in 1880. And it shows a woman seated in a Parisian drawing room enjoying tea with an unidentified visitor. We know one is at home, the one on the left, and one is a visitor, because one is wearing a hat and gloves and one of them isn't. In her unconventional composition, Cassatt obscured her guest's face with a teacup, and she accorded equal space in the composition to the tea set, which, as we heard, was a Cassatt family heirloom. Look how big it is compared to the people. How can you make an inanimate object as important in the composition as the human beings? That's a very unconventional idea. Well, this seems like a very feminine subject, and I want to say that I think Cassatt's work has suffered a little bit by being made to seem even more domestic than perhaps it was really meant to be. Here, for example, because of the intimacy of the scene and the identification of this particular silver set as something Cassatt owned, the room is most often described in the literature as the Cassatt's carefully appointed Paris apartment, and the woman on the left as Cassatt's sister, Lydia. But she doesn't look like Lydia. The blonde and the brunette appear repeatedly in Cassatt's work. And I'm showing you here on the right another painting called In the Loge from the National Gallery of Art, a blonde and a brunette model. What if all these women are professional models? How does that idea change our idea about Cassatt as a professional? That she didn't only paint her family, but she had a studio and hired models. I don't mean to imply that Cassatt didn't use her family as subjects, and here are two paintings that we know are, in fact, Lydia. On the left, Lydia crocheting at the garden in Marly from 1880 in the Metropolitan's collection, and on the right, her painting Autumn, of Lydia seated on a Parisian park bench in 1880 from the Petit Palais in Paris. And I would remind you that, of course, Cassatt's family was with her in Paris. They were all there. Her parents, her sister Lydia, lived with her from 1877. They spent the rest of their lives there. Cassatt returned to the United States only once, mostly because she got hideously seasick. Here again, two portraits of her family, her brother Alexander on the left with his son Robbie from 1884, and on the right, an amazing picture, amazingly still in a private collection, which you saw last week called Reading the Figaro from 1878. It shows Cassatt's mother, Catherine Kelso Cassatt, who obviously, because she's reading the Figaro, was fluent in French, interested in culture and current events, which are well reported in Le Figaro, which was devoted not to society, but to politics and literature. Cassatt really, as I said, tried to integrate into French society, and the fact that her brother Alexander, who you see on the left, was the president of the Pennsylvania Railroad, could have put Cassatt unquestionably at the core of the American colony in Paris, that group of wealthy expatriates who lived in Paris and had quite a presence there. But Cassatt had no patience for any of it. She thought it was too social. She kept it at arm's length and felt and wrote that it was a distraction that threatened to keep her from her work. And in Cassatt, the thing we have to remember the most is that it is her work that's the most important thing. She fought hard to be recognized as an equal to her French colleagues, again, not as a woman artist, but as an artist. And in fact, I just want for a minute to take her work totally out of the context of woman artist, and perhaps even out of the context of American art. Let's look at these two pictures. On the right, Cassatt's young girl at a window, 1883-4, formerly in the collection of the Corcoran, now at the National Gallery of Art. On the left, Gustav Caillebotte's Man at a Window from 1876. Is the insularity and domesticity that we so often see in the literature about Cassatt, the sheltered woman protected from the city by the balcony, only able to look as an outsider, is that so different, really, from what Caillebotte shows in his picture? And what do we make of the fact that both Cassatt and Degas made images of women bathing, and in fact, exchanged these two paintings? Cassatt's Girl Arranging Her Hair from 1886, National Gallery, and on the right, Degas' Woman Bathing in a Shallow Tub from 1886 at the Metropolitan. Degas' art is for the very few, wrote Cassatt to Havemeyer. I cannot believe that many would care for the nude I have. Those things are for painters and connoisseurs. Clearly putting herself in both camps, painter and connoisseur. And isn't it interesting, actually, that Cassatt experimented with a depiction of the nude? This is a print in the MFA's collection, Standing Nude with a Towel, again made at around 1879 at that moment of La Jour et la Nuit. Of all the American collectors Cassatt advised, all of them had doubtless seen Cassatt's Degas nude at upper left again in her Paris apartment, and every one of them owned Degas nudes. I'm just showing you two others here. The one at the center belonged to Theodate Pope and is now at Hillstead, and the one at the bottom right belonged to the Bostonian Sarah Choate Sears and is now in the collection at Harvard. So Cassatt promoted these works, didn't find them inappropriate for women. And what about this image of mothers and children that so many people write about Cassatt as the childless woman making up for her lack by doing nothing but painting mothers and children again and again, an appropriate subject for the women artist? What happens when we look at one of Cassatt's Mothers and Children on the left from 1889, now in the collection at Wichita, a painting I love, and I'm very sorry it ended up in Wichita since it started in Boston in Sarah Sears's collection. What happens when we compare it with Renoir on the right, Mother Nursing Her Child from 1886? Which one is more sentimental, in fact? What I love so much about Cassatt's work is the way it emphasizes the relationship between the two figures, the solidity and weight of that child, but at the same time, the way that it all just dissolves into paint at the bottom of the composition, which keeps it always a painting in your eye rather than an illustration. And let's also not forget Cassatt's relationship with art of the past, which I think we'll be hearing more about next week. This is Cassatt's Ellen Mary from the MFA's collection on the left from 1896, and I'm comparing it with Velázquez's Infanta Margarita, a well-known painting now in Vienna on the right. Cassatt was always entranced with the work of the old masters, and Elliot talked about it last week when she showed the Luca della Robbia sculpture in connection with the mothers and children. She didn't abandon tradition, she reinvented it. And somehow to me, Ellen Mary, with her self-possession, sitting in that chair with her big gown, has all the self-possession of those insular Velázquez infantas. She didn't forget the people that she'd left behind. You'll remember, I read at the beginning of the lecture, her words to Emily Sartain, "I cannot tell you what I suffer for the want of seeing a good picture." And she saw all the good pictures she could, and she worked with American collectors in museums to bring those great pictures across the Atlantic, encouraging American collectors in museums to buy the old master painting she most admired. And more than anything, I hope I'll leave you today with the idea that Cassatt was simply enraptured with the world of art. And I leave you with two pictures to make that point, both by Degas, both showing Cassatt. The MFA's visit to the museum from somewhere around 1877-80, on the left and on the right, a print with pastel over it of Cassatt in the painting gallery at the Louvre from about the same time. As Cassatt's Philadelphia friend George Biddle recalled of his many visits with Cassatt when he was studying in Paris, tea parties that turned into heated discussions about contemporary art, he found it, and I quote, extraordinary that a woman of such social rigidity could have preserved such a white hot passion for art. Thank you. Thank you.
So we have time for some questions. We do ask that those of you who are departing now, please do so quietly and raise your hand if you have a question, and please wait for the microphone to come to you.
I've noticed in last week's lecture and in yours, little has been said about Cassatt's mother in terms of her role in ensuring what would have happened had her mother not accompanied her to Paris, et cetera. Little has been said about that.
The question, in case you couldn't hear, and it was a little hard to hear, was about Cassatt's mother and the role that she played in ensuring her daughter's success. What would have happened if she didn't come to live in Paris with her? These what-ifs questions are very hard to know the answer to. Having a sort of gut feeling about Cassatt and her determination and drive to become an artist, I suspect that she was delighted that her parents came to live with her and that it provided the safe domestic setting that they would have asked her to have. It prevented them from worrying about her as an American alone in Paris. Obviously, her mother provided her with some subject matter, and she shows up in a couple of Cassatt's works. It locates her family in Paris, which makes her not homesick in a way that a lot of American artists who expatriated were always homesick. And it's interesting to me that both Sargent and Cassatt's families lived with them in Paris, and they are two of the artists who feel the least homesick. But I suspect that if her family hadn't approved, she would have found another way, that her sister would have come, or she would have ended up living with her friend Eliza Haldeman or her friend Emily Sartain or something. And there are examples of women artists in Paris who did just that. Thank you.
Was the negative press, excuse me, that the Impressionists received in some ways helpful?
Question is, was the negative press that the Impressionists received helpful? I guess I don't have to repeat the question if you have a microphone. Good question, and I don't really know the answer to it because there were so masses and masses and masses of press. In fact, there's a two-volume book called The New Painting Documentation that includes all of the reviews of all 8 Impressionist exhibitions, if you're interested. It's an amazing resource to have. But I suspect that the negative press was so just critical of the avant-garde in general, and this group of painters so not interested in conforming to traditional ideas, that I doubt that they would have found it especially helpful. Part of the reason that I can't answer you is that whole group of other painters who exhibited with the Impressionists 1 or 2 times and then didn't were, for example, the artists who showed in the first show. Did they change and never show again with the Impressionist group based on that negative criticism? And that's something I simply don't know the answer to. I suspect my colleagues in Art of Europe might have a better handle on that. But a lot of them are artists that even I've never heard of.
Two questions, actually. One occurred to me when you talked about her submitting a painting to a jury. She probably didn't send over a slide or take a picture with her smartphone. She had to actually physically present the picture, is that right?
Yes. Artists had to bring their works in person for submission to the jury by a certain deadline.
And the other is, apart from that one fuzzy picture, did she do nudes at all?
Question is, did she do nudes? The answer is, we don't know. We have the print. It's not a very common print in her oeuvre. We're very fortunate to have it in our collection. What we don't know is what we don't have left. That's the question with any artist. I suspect, frankly, that she did, because any artist who wanted to paint the human figure would have attempted that as part of their work. But there, to my knowledge, except for babies, no surviving examples of an adult nude in oil that I know about. Do you know of any, Elliot? Lots of naked babies. Lots and lots of naked babies. So, if I could just go back to your first question for a second. Part of what we need to think about when we're looking at women artists and why their paintings might look different is the issue that you raise about you have to bring your work to the salon for it to be judged. So think about the scale and size of some of those big academic pictures. If you want to paint like that, you have to have a professional art studio. You can't do it in your living room. And you have to have assistants to help you move it around. Some women did that. Rosa Bonheur certainly painted on a large scale. Cassatt's mural, which was not a judged painting, but was certainly on that scale, was something that she had to arrange a special studio set up for and have assistants to help her with. That's something that some women just didn't feel comfortable doing. And I think that part of the reason we see this and only part of it, but part of the reason we see a great flourishing of women artists in the late 19th century is that art changes, and the smaller scale of things meant to be not for the church or a public setting or the salon, so on and so forth. Domestic scale and the ability to carry it around yourself has an impact on how many women feel that this is something in, with which they can engage. So there are lots and lots of issues that come together here.
Would it have been considered scandalous for a woman to exhibit a nude?
Would it have been considered scandalous for a woman to exhibit a nude? I think it depends on where it happened. I do know of women who painted nudes during this period, but it depends who your audience is and where the show takes place. And it certainly becomes much more common later.
Our next question will be in the back.
I'm interested in the fact that in the 19th century, at least in England, while fathers would have been quite distressed if their daughters went to Paris to become a woman artist, they did encourage their daughters to paint as, that was part of your education as a young woman. And I wondered if that was in a way a safety outlet, that it was okay for your daughter to sort of be part of your education to do elegant watercolors, but to divert her from going off to Paris and doing it in a serious way.
Very perceptive comment. You'll have to have me back for my diatribe on women artists. Watercolors, pastels, and miniature painting are the three media that earlier in the 19th century were considered pretty much acceptable for women. And you are absolutely correct, and not just in England, learning how to draw and learning how to make a good watercolor was very much a part of every well-brought-up person's education. Actually, also, boys were, like Sargent, for example, were encouraged to make watercolor journals, for example, of early travels. So it's very much a part of it. I didn't read you the whole quote that I have about how it was appropriate for lady artists to so-called tickle the ivories. In other words, make miniature paintings. But a lot of women weren't satisfied with that. And there are women painters much earlier in the 19th century. That's a whole nother lecture. Happy to give it to you someday. but probably some parents did try to divert their daughters in that way. And it takes a lot of, let's call it leaning in order to do what your parents don't want you to do.
Can you tell us if Cassatt's work has been exhibited or is now exhibited frequently in Europe?
Very smart question. Cassatt's work, by and large, resides almost entirely in the United States. There's a lovely painting I showed you of Lydia at the Petit Palais. There are a couple at the Orsay. There is a beautiful mother and child in Bilbao. She's not very well known in Europe. It's something that happened during her own career when issues of nationalism start to play into these exhibitions. And she was enraged, for example, when her dealer left her out of an important show of the Impressionists, because she wasn't French. So that starts to play into it from an early time. She's collected much more widely in the US. And it's only, I would say, fairly recently that her work is starting to be appreciated in Europe, partly through a couple of shows that have taken place of women Impressionists in general in Europe, partly through some efforts by the Terra Foundation to promote American art to an international audience. And I can tell you that I learned from our next speaker, Nancy Mull Matthews, who will be speaking not next week, but in 2 weeks, so that we avoid school vacation week. Nancy has told me that the Jacquemart André Museum in Paris is now talking about doing a Cassatt exhibition. So that's great news, because she needs to be appreciated in Europe in as much as she is here, and taken more seriously, frankly, as a painter here as well.